Hello everyone, I'm going to start this video with a very simple scenario and let's see what exactly you think about it. Imagine you log into Facebook and Facebook asks you, hey, can you give me your Gmail password so that I can go to your Gmail account, search for all your contacts and then figure out which of those contacts are actually present on Facebook so that you can send the friend request. While this asks looks very innocent, but it is asking your Gmail password. Imagine Facebook is asking your Gmail password that, hey, can you give your Gmail password so that I can get some data from Gmail? And that's very scary. And that's what the case in 2007. I'm not sure about you, but I am definitely not going to share my Gmail password to Facebook or Facebook password to Gmail. And all of these different companies sharing password with each other was very common back in 2007. So this is how the screen of Facebook used to look in 2007. That is, you open Facebook and people used to ask for searching for the friends on Facebook using Gmail. And they even used to ask for the password. So things like login with Google, login with Microsoft, or login with Facebook or any other website was not existent or maybe not very popular. And then many security people raise the concern. And I'm sure you might have also figured out the issue here. What if you enter the password and this particular website is not owned by a good person and that person steals your password? What would you do? You can't do anything. You would not even know that your password is stolen. And then what will happen is that if you share your Gmail password to hundreds of such platforms, then even if one of those platforms is compromised, the only option you have is to go ahead and change your Gmail password. And not just the Gmail password, God forbid you use same password in multiple websites, because that's what we all humans do. There are lots of recommendations to have different passwords for different websites, but of course it's not humanly possible to have so many passwords and keep track of so many passwords on so many websites. So you have to go ahead and change not just the Gmail password but all the websites where you are using the same password. So that was the case earlier, but today with the help of Oauth, with the help of this login with Google and login with Microsoft and login with Facebook buttons, you don't have to share the password with a particular platform. You actually click and the redirection happens to login.google.com or login.microsoft.com. There you enter the credential of Gmail or of Microsoft or of Facebook, and then the redirection happens. So in this way, you are safe. So that's the overall idea. But today what I'm going to do is to simplify it. Simplify it in a way which we all understand. So this is what Oauth does, is that it helps in the third party login. That is, if you are on Facebook, it will help you to log in via Google. And not just a third party login, within Google also, if there are multiple platforms like YouTube, like Gmail, like different other platforms, then the same login button helps within the company as well. So within a company also, they would have one identity provider. That's what they call. That's the industrial name. Or within Microsoft, or within a company, or within the Microsoft products, they will have this identity provider. And then all the other products like Teams or like Outlook, they will integrate with this sign in with Microsoft button. So this particular sign in with Microsoft or sign in with Google is very much helpful, because it centralizes the logic of authentication, authorization, and all those things. And also it helps in not sharing the password. So that's the idea today. What I'm going to do today is to show you how things work at the basic level. So what I'm going to do is to use Postman. So I'll use Postman to help you understand login with Microsoft flow, that how does the login with Microsoft flow works. And here I'm not going to use any HTML, any JavaScript, anything. I'm not even going to write any code. I'm just going to use Postman and bunch of APIs so that you understand that what are the APIs called one by one by one, so that you understand how things work. We are not going to write any backend code, any frontend code, anything whatsoever. We'll have a very simple Postman, and we'll have a bunch of other things like Azure. So you can create an Azure account so that you understand how the flow works. It's a free of cost account which you can create for yourself. There is no charge which will be needed here. And this particular link will be very helpful for you. I'll paste the link in the description where the Postman collection is there. So basically you can just click on this run on Postman and it will give you a bunch of APIs. So that's what we are going to do here. Nothing fancy. It will be as simple as making bunch of calls on Postman. And there is one more thing I'll use is this Bees Scripter website. And trust me, it's not very complex. What happens is that in the OpenAuth flow, there is a redirection which happens. So that redirection which will happen, it will happen to this particular website, what you call this bscripter.com. So the redirection will happen here so that we can see what data is being sent to us. So it will be used only for the redirection purpose, but in your case, you will have some backend service where the callback will happen. So don't get overwhelmed with all these things, but it will be very simple for you to understand. So what we'll do is that, first of all, you go to this Azure, portal.azure.com, and then you log in, you get some subscription so that you can work. Then you go here, click on these three lines, and you go to Microsoft Entra ID. So Microsoft Entra ID is nothing but a identity provider or a facility given by Microsoft to have a login by Microsoft stuffs. So it has lots of things, not just the login by Microsoft stuff, but we are just going to focus on this stuff here. So you go here, you click on this default directory, and then you go to this app registration. So whenever you have a login by anything, you need to have an app. So here we'll create one new app. Let's name it something. Let's name it SDE cohort. And then let's make it accounts in any organization or any personal account as well. So we'll choose this option, but all these options have different meaning and they are being documented by Microsoft as well. Let's choose web because that's what we are going to see today, but there are other options like mobile or the native, like, you know, the single page applications. So there is some nuance between single page and web, but we'll just choose the simplest one for this example. So we have this web, and then let's do one thing. Let's have the endpoint as the one which we chose here and paste it here. And then let's click on register. So we have registered this particular application, and then let's expose some API so that API can be used. You see a client ID is created, which will be very helpful later down the line. So we'll create expose an API. We'll expose a particular API permission, in fact. So we'll do add, and then we'll make a Microsoft Graph application permission, and we'll give the mail read. So this is a high privilege information where when you log in by Microsoft, it will ask you for mail.read, but you can have other permissions as well. So you do this add, and then you do this grant consent. So this is just a step by stuff. All the steps are written by Microsoft. So nothing new here. And then what we have here is the client ID, which we'll copy from here. We'll go to Postman and we'll paste the client ID in the Postman collection, which is given to us. And there are various things which are configured in the Postman collection. And this is the endpoint which we are going to use. So in the Postman collection, which is there by Microsoft, we have this flow, authorization flow. Then there are other flow as well, but we are just going to focus on the first one today. So that we understand what's going on. So we have this client ID, which we copied just now. The response type is code. So we need authorization codes. That's why the response type is code. There are other options mentioned in the doc. I'll share the link. Then we have a redirection URL, as we talked about the URL, anubhav.free.something. So this will be your backend service. The response mode we need in the query param. So we need the authorization or the token we need in the form of query. And the scope is configured here, like the mail.read. And this is the state. So when a redirection comes, you can verify is the state correct or not. So those things also you can verify. Now let me do one thing. Let me copy everything from here, do a control C, and then go to the browser and paste it. And let's see what happens here. So it asks for something like email address. Let me enter the email address here and then click on next. Let's see what happens. Now you see it asks for a few things. Like it asks me to, do you allow me to access the email, your email or not? So it's asking me a bunch of things. So you would have seen this thing a lot, right? And it's on the account.live.com. So basically you can trust this website because this is by Microsoft. So instead of, you know, me or any developer asking the password of Microsoft, we are going to have a redirection to Microsoft website where you will enter whatever you have to enter, and then there will be a callback to the to you. So let's click on accept and let's see what happens here. So I have clicked on accept and you see a redirection happened to this anubhav.free, and then there was a code which is sent back here with a state. So now this code is actually very important. Now this code, actually here in my interceptor also, I got this particular code. So let's just copy this particular code, which is important for us for the further API. So you got this code from Microsoft and this code is valid, I think, only for 10 minutes. So within 10 minutes, you have to follow other steps. So this token request. So in the token request, what you have to send is the code, which is copied from the browser. So I'll just copy the code here. So this call will happen from backend to backend because the redirection happened to your backend only, not to your front end. So here you need to enter the client secret. Now client secrets will never be in the front end. The front end code had only the client ID when the redirection happened, when you clicked on the login with Microsoft. But when the call came to the backend, so in the backend, you will have client secret, which will be only available to you. Nobody else will have the client secret. So let's do one thing here is that let's create a client secret. Let's go back to Azure portal and click on certificates and secret, and let's create any secret here. We name it anything, does not matter. And then click on create. We get some client secret, copy it from here, and then paste in the client secret place. And the client ID we already have from the previous place. We copy it from the previous one. We paste it here. And have we copied it correctly? Yeah. And then we have the scope. That is, we need the mail.read access. We have a redirect URL. We have authorization code. That's what we need here. And yeah, we have everything here to be sent. And all these things, again, you can go to the Microsoft documentation to find the relevance of all these things. So let's send and see what happens. I think everything is correct except for the redirection URL. We can actually fix the redirection URL as well here, just to be on the safer side. Why would we want to have incorrect values? Let's send and see. So you see, you got an access token, which will be used to get the data. And then you have a refresh token as well. So you, in the response, you are getting a refresh token, which will be used to refresh the data. So now you got an access token, which will be valid for 3600 seconds. So what exactly is 3600 seconds? It's 1 hour. So this particular token will be valid for you for 1 hour. So till 1 hour, you keep on using this token. And when the token expires, you use this refresh token to get a new access token. So now let's just copy this token. And actually before, yeah, we can actually make the call using, you know, there is a call called as /messages. And here we'll just give the token. So we'll paste the token here and we'll see what exactly we get. So let's see what we are getting here. So we are getting some data, some of the things in my mail. So we are able to get the data here. Now, what if this 1 hour has passed and this particular token becomes invalid because this particular token will be valid only for an hour? Then what do? You use this refresh token. You copy this. You keep it saved somewhere in your cache or somewhere and you copy it. And then you call this token refresh or refresh token API. And here, what you do is that you put the refresh token in the refresh token place. And then you need client ID and the client secret again. So we have a client ID and a client secret. We'll just copy it from the previous one. We'll paste them here, client ID. And then we also have a client secret. We'll again copy the same thing from the previous one. We'll paste it here. Redirect URL is anyway there. So we have a client ID, scope is correct. Redirect URL is also correct. The grant type is the refresh token this time. Client secret is also, we have put something, and then the refresh token. Now let's send this API and see the result. So you see, we got a new token. Now with the help of this new token, we'll keep on working for 60 minutes. That's 1 hour. And then when this expires, then we'll make the call again. So likewise, you can get the data, you know, you can keep on getting the data. You can even request for the refresh token. So yeah, so that's how the things work. And I hope the things were clear, that you can actually request for the refresh token. You get the refresh token for 60 minutes and then you can keep on getting the, the refresh token. So here actually there is some parameter I have to check where you can actually request for the subsequent, refresh token. But that's the idea, that you can actually get the refresh token here. There might be some API I don't want to, put more time because the video is anyway very long now. So yeah, here you can make the calls, you can get the subsequent refresh token and the access token, and you can, keep on making the calls. So what it will help you to do is that, you will have a faster APIs, and the accesses will be done by the Microsoft here. So here you see the login is being done by login.microsoft.com. So if you have your own website, let's say anubhav.com. So Anubhav is not going to ask any of your Microsoft password, because Anubhav needs your email. So you can give a very limited permission, that you can just give me permission to read your mail, or maybe read your friends or read your contacts. So very limited information you can share with me. You can choose not to share everything with me. So when the consent screen comes, so you will able to give me permission only what is needed. If I ask too much of a permission, you will say no. Something is wrong. I'm not going to allow such a high privilege permission. So those things you can take care of here, and the login will happen on login.microsoft. So it will not happen on my endpoint. So that's a good thing. And then, I'll be dealing with only the token. So the token will have limited privilege and my things will work. So I hope this video was helpful. I hope you were able to see how the login process overall works. What I'll do is that I found a few links by Microsoft very helpful. Please check out how things work. And this particular documentation, I find it more helpful compared to other websites' documentation. So that's my personal bias. But yeah, I would say that I have checked other links and they are not as helpful. Just a full disclosure, I work for Microsoft, and maybe that's why I am more comfortable with this particular website. But definitely do check out how the login works, and do check out how login works using Postman. There are other methods to login as well. There are libraries given by the companies, so you can just import those libraries and think will work. But looking into them using Postman is definitely a new thing, and it will help you to understand things better. So yeah, that's it from my side for this video. I hope this video was helpful. Till the next time, bye.